You're listening to the audio production of Galatians Audio Bible Study by Jada Edwards, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Galatians includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambiance of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching. While not required for the audio experience, these studies are designed to partner with a coordinating study guide sold separately.
Have you ever had a time in your life where you did not feel accepted? It's probably not the most pleasant memory. We've all had those times, but I have some great news for you. We are going to read a letter together that reminds us that we have liberating acceptance. I'm so glad that you're joining me for the study of the book of Galatians. It is a passionate letter written by the Apostle Paul. So if you ever hear a Pauline epistle, it's a fancy way of saying it's a letter written by Paul. He has some really good things to tell the churches at Galatia, and I think they're going to be very relevant for us. This letter gives us a lot of contrast. He's talking to a group of people who he just was with less than 2 years prior. He shared the gospel with them. He explained to them what it really looks like to be a follower of Jesus. Now, the churches of Galatia were a Gentile group of churches. That's who Paul was called to, and we get it because we're all Gentiles. If you're not Jewish by birth and heritage, you're a Gentile. And so Paul had a unique ministry to these churches. He shared with them how passionate he was about the gospel, how life-changing it was for him, and how it could do the same for them. So throughout the book, you will see a lot of contrast. He tells us that the gospel is Jesus only, that nothing needs to be added. And then he will remind us of what it looks like to be a slave versus being free, what it looks like to follow rules versus living by faith, what it looks like to walk in the spirit or give way to the flesh. You'll see a lot of contrast because he's trying to help these young believers understand what it means to be fully accepted in Jesus. This acceptance, let me tell you something, you cannot earn it. It is only by the grace and plan of God and through the obedience of Jesus and because of our faith that we have this full, unconditional acceptance. But when we don't embrace it, when we don't understand it, we can find ourselves in some situations similar to these churches in Galatia. What you're going to see in this particular letter is a lot of passion. Paul is a little harsh, and I think maybe that's why I relate to him, because he gives me an excuse to be very direct when it comes to the Word of God. If you look through the other letters or epistles that Paul has written, you will see that he opens by saying, "By the will of God, I am Paul the Apostle." And then he'll usually spend several verses thanking them for how great they are, that they've provided him joy, he's pleased with what they're doing. Not so with the letter to Galatia. He starts off by declaring who he is, and he goes immediately into things that he's heard about them, reports that are unpleasing, reports that are making him question if they really got the message of the gospel. So you're going to see some harsh words. He says, "Who has bewitched you or deceived you?" At one point in the letter, he calls them foolish. I mean, these are words that are pretty harsh for a pastor to be writing to churches that he's led. But it's an urgency that's still filled with love. If you think about your kid running out into the street and about to be hit by a car, when you snatch them, you're not going to pat them on the back first. There's no time for niceties. There's an urgent situation that could change or end their life if you don't do something about it. So what you're going to see in a lot of direct language in this letter is Paul saying, this is urgent. This is not, I hope you work it out if you get a minute. This is, you have missed the gospel and you are totally going to live like the slaves you were before you heard the gospel if you don't get it. So when he talks about this acceptance, Paul is not talking just about his acceptance, even though he's going to show us that he stands on the authority of Christ because he is accepted. We'll start with that. But what he's really saying is that you, the churches of Galatia, and us, you today, you are fully accepted. That means that God has already done the work, that you don't have to work to earn anything. It's been done. And so whatever that memory was that may have come to your mind when I asked you what it felt to be unaccepted, I want you to know that there is not any rejection on earth, nothing you've ever experienced, that is greater than the acceptance that you have in Jesus. There's not any insecurity. There's not a doubt. There's not any embarrassment. There's not any shame. There's not anything that's happened in your entire life that is greater than the acceptance that Jesus guarantees us. God loved us so much that he created a plan that we could not have ever achieved on our own. And when we don't get that, we find ourselves subject to the bondage that we were in before we even knew Jesus. So Paul is basically saying, what's the point? So what you'll see as we walk through Galatians is Paul giving a very passionate and urgent but harsh assurance. There's love underneath all of this, but he's very direct because this is critical. And I think this will be so good for us because in the church today, we face a lot of the same issues. We struggle, we wrestle with it. We know we're accepted in our minds, but what we live out, the words we say, the thoughts that we think, they don't always support that. And listen, I'm talking about more than positive thinking. I'm talking about more than good inspirational mantras. I'm talking about understanding that the core of who you are, once you place faith in Jesus, you are transformed. You are made new. You are forever a part of the family of God. So let's jump in. Let's see what Paul says to this church that he really does love, but he gets a little harsh with. Verse 1 says, Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers who are with me to the church of Galatia. Verse 3, 4, and 5 get heavy really quick. He says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father. Verse 5, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. So in the first few verses, Paul is saying, I'm not only an apostle, but I'm called by God through Jesus Christ, because he knew that the Judaizers, this was a group of Orthodox Jews who had kind of mixed a little tradition with the gospel, they had the ear of the Galatians. He knew that the Judaizers were telling the Galatians that Paul had no authority, because if you know a little bit about the New Testament, and if you don't, let me tell you, there were the original 12 that Jesus walked with, those disciples, and then the 11 after the betrayal of Judas. And most Orthodox Jews said that was it. Those were the original. Those are the apostles. So Paul kind of comes as an outlier later as he has this Damascus Road encounter. He has an encounter with Jesus, and God calls him from being a persecutor of the church to now being a proclaimer of God's word. And that's a story that resonates with so many of us. But it kind of made people question his authority. And so he starts off this letter very directly saying he is not from man, nor through an agency of man, some of your versions may say. Now, I think it's interesting he says that because he knows he's about to contradict things the Judaizers have said. Now, the Judaizers were Orthodox Jews, as I said before, but many of them also held position in the church. And if you know anything about church denominations, position and title can sometimes become too important in church denominations. Now, this is not to say anything negative about any specific denomination, but when you miss the role that God has called us to and we make the position that man has given us bigger, we usually have problems. So Paul makes it very clear that I'm called to be who I am, not because of a position that a man has given me. I haven't been elected or appointed, and this will never expire. He's making it very clear that this is a direct call from God and because of Jesus Christ. He says in verse 4, he gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age according to the will of our God and Father. Now, that doesn't even have anything to do with Paul's role, but he's kind of throwing in a little bit of gospel truth. He's saying, do you understand what God has done? He's delivered us from this present evil age. He's already preparing them and letting them know we're about to dive in. We're going to refresh on doctrine because you've missed some things. So Paul explains to them his authority. He explains to them who God is and what God has come to deliver us from. And then he says, now let's jump in even further. Look at verse 6. He says, I am astonished. Now, this is kind of harsh for biblical language. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ, and you're turning to a different gospel. He's astonished. He's taken aback. And then he says, you didn't kind of veer slightly off track. He says, you're deserting him. You have completely abandoned God, who's called you to the real gospel, which is the grace of Christ, and you are turning to a different gospel. In verse 7, he says, not that there is another one. There's only one gospel. So when you get off track, you've left the gospel. There's no variations. There's no shades of gray. It's the gospel. And if you add anything to it or take anything away, you're doing something else. He says, there's not another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. Verse 8 says, but even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. He's not mincing words, y'all. He's saying that I don't care if it's an angelic being. Anybody coming to tell you that the gospel that I've already given you has any difference or variation or needs anything added to it, they should be accursed, not reprimanded, not put in time out. This is significant. This is heresy. He's saying you've taken the work that Jesus did on the cross and through the resurrection, and you're trying to alter it. Any alteration is a complete distortion of the gospel. In verse 9, he goes on and he says, as we've said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. Now, I don't know if you have kids or nieces or nephews or godchildren, but when you are really passionate, you repeat yourself in just a matter of moments. You're trying to make sure they get it. He says, let anyone who's telling you something different be accursed. And in the very next verse, he says the same thing again. It's kind of like, make sure you do your homework and clean up this kitchen when I come back. What did I say again? Homework kitchen. And if you have children that get a little distracted, you say, tell me back what I said is homework kitchen, because you want to repeat yourself to make sure that they understand your point. So this is a bit of the parental side coming out. He's talking to a group of people who knew what the weight of a curse meant. He says it twice for emphasis. In verse 10, he goes on to say, for now, am I seeking the approval of man or God? Or am I trying to please man? If I was still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. So let's stop right there. Let's talk about a few things that this acceptance gives us. It sets us free in so many ways. One of the things it gives us is the authority that we have to stand on. Paul opens this letter saying, I have authority as an apostle because I've been accepted fully by Jesus Christ. I had a call and you cannot bring it into question. I wonder how many times we hold back or miss divine moments because we say we live in authority, but we don't really walk in the authority that Jesus has given us. Listen, this authority that Jesus gives us because we're accepted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.